know how it all starts. Born in 1897, from the beginning, you know I've always been good with school, studying English and rhetoric, all that jazz. I must thank you in that I was fortunate enough to attend university. But then you decided to test us. In 1914, the First World War broke out, and I was forced to take a break from my studies and join the Navy. Despite being overseas, it was the right thing to help fight the good fight. It was taxing, it was humbling, it was a true test indeed. As the war reached an end, my studies concluded at Boston College. I got my degree, the war to end all wars was over. I was set to write articles for the Knights of Columbus, a Catholic men's organization that published a modestly titled magazine called The Columbia. The future was looking up. My mom was very proud.
I'm so proud of you.
I should thank you too for allowing me to take part in the very first generation of the Catholic Book Club. We read everything from St. Augustine's Confessions to things like Hildegard, and even Christopher Dawson's Religion and Culture. The following year, it probably changed my life in the most dramatic of ways, starting with my marriage, of course. Agnes Bevington. What a gal. Also, one of my fondest memories of that year was being able to interview President Coolidge for the Boston Post. I'm still surprised to be one of the only journalists that was allowed in, and for this I count my blessings. One evening, I was thinking what it truly meant to be blessed with all my good fortune. I thought, how could the Christian mind be further challenged to understand true wealth, true thanks? The infinite wealth, not in material things, but in you. You see, he spent all of his inherited wealth nearly as soon as he got it in order to live the rest of his life among the poor. Mr. Blue, that is. Happy poverty, if you will. The ultimate free spirit. Up until then, my life was great, but you showed me true success. And thereafter I wrote Mr. Blue, my life changed forever. I was getting offered to write so many movies, I didn't know what to do with myself.
Aren't you going to give me a little credit?
What for?
Well, I've proved once and for all that the limb is mightier than the thumb.
The way the evidence is piled up against me, I can't say I blame them much. And I'm quite willing to go, sir, when they voted that way. But before that happens, I've got a few things I want to say to this body. I tried to say them once before, and I got stopped colder than a mackerel. Well, I'd like to get them said this time, sir. And as a matter of fact, I'm not going to leave this body until I do get them said.
President, will the senator yield?
The senator yield?
No, sir, I'm afraid not. No, sir. I yielded the floor once before, if you can remember, and I was practically never heard of again. No, sir.
Though we were making films and playing with fictitious characters, we weren't oblivious to the growing tensions overseas. For whatever your reasons, we decided to give the world another test. More vigorous yet no less painful, for our morals and spirit, we were at the verge of breaking. It was World War II. As detrimental as it was, the war didn't seem to slow down the rate at which folks were attending the cinema. Now, I personally think people used it as a distraction, a brief break from the rest of the world, if you will. Then again, how could anyone be mad watching Josephine Hull with James Stewart?
There, mon cher, Monsieur Matthews, is something to gladden the heart of every citizen west of the Rockies.
What is it?
The Seattle speech. A masterpiece of rhetoric, if I do say so.
Who's going to make it?
You are, of course.
Oh, really? I thought maybe the setup had changed and that you were the candidate.
No, I'm saving myself for 52.
Yeah, well, you better save the speech, too.
How do you like that? What do? Just sit around here with egg in my face? I'm the expert that keeps you from climbing out on limbs.
That's where the big red apples are.
Where?
Out on the limbs.
Mama.
All right, if you don't want to be president.
You just line up the babies for me to kiss on an obvious cinch.
Well, that reminds me, do I know any babies in Seattle?
I'm Hans Christian Andersen, and this is an April day. It's full of the magic I need to speed me on my way. My pocketbook has an empty look, I limp on a lumpy shoe. So I turn into a flying fish or a millionaire with a rocking chair and a dumpling in my stew. I'm Hans Christian Andersen, Andersen, that's who.
Thanks, God. Thanks for everything. You know, I'm not perfect, but I'm sure as hell gonna keep trying.